mean we're going to call you or anything, but we'd just like to know you're here. If you've been here the first time today, or if you've been here 100 times, we still want to know that you're here. Also, today is Veterans Day, or really tomorrow is, but we'd like to recognize all who have served in our armed forces. If you have been in the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, the Marines, the Coast Guard, would you please stand so that we can recognize you? Thank you. We do appreciate your service. Also, yesterday was a big day for Princeton Band. We went to state and we came in 9th in the state in our class, and I think that's something to be recognized. You will notice on your bulletin under the announcements that Wednesday we are doing the Christmas boxes, the child shoe boxes. There are some items listed there that still need to be filled. If you feel led, please bring them in before Wednesday, because that's when they're going to pack the boxes up. Also, Monday is our second Monday. And this is a ministry that we've done for a long time. It's very dear to my heart. If you would like to serve in this ministry, we need desserts. They need to be here by 3 p.m. on Monday. We also need kitchen help from 1 until 6. Anytime in there that you're available, they would love to have you, I'm sure. And deliveries, be here no later than 4:15. We deliver about 95% of those that we prepare, and we prepare anywhere up, well, actually we plan for 200, so it's quite a ministry, and we could use your help. Now then, we're going to do what we call passing of the peace. Stand and mingle and say hello to your friends. Say hello to those you don't recognize and welcome them to Hillside. When the chimes ring, please return to your seats.
Yeah. I think we had more veterans stand.
We ask you now to center yourself and prepare yourself for worship by listening to the prelude. You stand as you are able for our call to worship. The words will be on the screen. They're also printed in your bulletin. There are times when our lives feel empty. Yet God is patient and listens to our cries. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on each one of us.
Heal our spirits, change our lives into joyful service to you.
Lord, we praise you and seek your calming spirit in our lives. Amen. Would you remain standing for our hymn, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
Thank you.
want to invite you now into a time of personal prayer with the Lord. We are a church that believes that prayer is powerful, and it is our direct line to the God who hears us and loves us and knows us and wants only good things for us. So we'll take a couple of moments of silent prayer. During that time, you are welcome to use that as you wish. We do have kneelers at the front of the worship center if you want to physically bow before the Lord. We have candle lighting stations at either side where you are invited to go and light a candle to tangibly lift a prayer or an honor or memory of someone. And we also have a prayer wall at the very back of the worship center where you are welcome to write out your prayers, and then on Tuesday our staff will lift those prayers for you. So use this time with the Lord as you need, and then we will come together in congregational prayer after that. And loving God, we bow before you in worship, in praise, and in prayer this morning, because you alone are worthy of all honor and all glory and all praise. And before we bring our need to you, Lord, before we ask for anything, we first bring you praise and gratitude, because you are so, so good to us. We thank you, Lord, for this day, for another opportunity to know you and to love as you loved. And we thank you, Lord, for this place where we can freely come together as the body of Christ, and we can worship and we can learn and we can grow. And we thank you, Lord, for answered prayer. Sometimes it's in large, obvious movements of your hand in our lives, but so often it's those small, unnoticeable ways. Give us eyes to see you at work, Lord, to recognize you in the people that you place before us, to recognize you in the way that there always seems to be just enough, to recognize you in what we so often call coincidence. Who are we, Lord, that you would be mindful of us. Lord God, you know the condition of our hearts this morning. You already know the worries, you already know the burdens that we bear, and we lift those to you now because we know that you hear our prayers, we know that you care, and we know that you do answer. And really what we're praying for in all of those worries and all of those burdens is for your ultimate healing, for your ultimate restoration in our brokenness. And so this morning, Lord, we pray your healing and your restoration in bodies that are plagued by disease, bodies that are crippled by aging or just by life circumstance. In your will and in your way, Lord, bring healing. Lord, we pray your healing and your restoration in minds that are racked with anxiety or with depression, with dementia, with physical masses. Lord, in your will and in your way, bring healing. Lord, we pray your healing and your restoration in relationships, so many relationships that have been broken by sin, by compromised values, by selfishness, relationships that have been broken by distrust. Lord, you call us in relationships to be a reflection of you and your love for us. And in your will and in your way, Lord, bring healing. And Lord, we pray your healing and restoration in hearts that have been hurt by the words or by the actions of the church, by the words or the actions of Christians who've spoken in judgment and not in love and have created a divide between you and your holy body. In your will and in your way, Lord, bring the healing that only you can heal. And as we remember veterans this time of year, we lift a special prayer for healing and for peace. Peace in the hearts and minds of those who have sacrificed so much to serve our country and to ensure our physical protection. And we pray this day that they will feel honored, that they would feel our gratitude, that they will feel seen and they will feel understood, because they've experienced so many things that so many of us will never be able to comprehend. We pray for peace in the hearts and minds of military families because they sacrifice as well. Lord, we pray for those who are separated physically by deployment and also those who are separated by the trauma that their loved ones have experienced. Lord, may they too feel honored and seen and understood. And ultimately, Lord, we pray for peace in our land. May we bring guns to silence. May our lasting tribute to all veterans be a renewed dedication to peace. May we remember the human cost of battle. And may our homes be homes of peace and justice. We pray, O Lord, that you would give us peace in our time. Lord God, meet us here this morning. May our eyes and our ears and our minds and our hearts be open to receive what you have for us this day, because you do have a word for each and every person who is here this morning. May we be open to receive. Thank you, Lord, that you hear our prayers. And we trust that in your mercy that you will answer. And we lift our voices as one now in that perfect prayer that your Son, Jesus Christ, taught us so long ago, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Would the ushers come forward to receive the offering, please?
Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high.
Lord of all creation. Hallelujah.
To the Lord of heaven and earth.
Hallelujah.
To the Lord of heaven and earth.
Hallelujah.
To the Lord of heaven. Our galaxy, you are holy,
holy. The universe declares your
we
majesty.
Declare your majesty, you are holy,
holy,
holy, holy, holy.
Giver of all good gifts, we ask that you accept these gifts as our token of our love for you. Bless this offering and the many ministries it supports here at Hillside and around the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Today we have a special for our children's moment. Would Chastity please come forward?
Good morning. Can I have my Hillside preschoolers come up with me, please? Spread out, guys and girls. This is a lot of kids today. Isn't this awesome? Okay, I need you guys spread down this way, too. Okay. We're going to do a couple songs for you this morning and our Bible verse that we've been working on. We have, in our preschool this year, we have 65 children enrolled. So, 65, I hear that's pretty awesome, isn't it? So we have a morning and afternoon preschool, and we are so blessed here to be with you guys, and we're blessed that you guys share this church with us. So we appreciate all that you do, and please just sit back and enjoy this. They're going to do My God Is So Big first. Are you guys ready? Okay, let's get Miss Jenny down there so she can help, because I don't know the motions. Boys and girls, we're going to do our Bible verse. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. you so much. You guys did such a good job. I'm so proud of you guys. Did you have fun?
Praise the Lord and good morning, everyone. Welcome to Hillside. Are you excited?
Yes.
Tell you one thing, kids will make you excited, won't they?
Yes.
Very hard to be a stick in the mud with young children around, and it is such a joy here at Hillside during the week when these young children are here. When I well, occasionally I'll stop and talk to the line of them. Sometimes they're right out here to go to the restroom. And it is so fascinating because all of them want to talk. All of them want to tell me what they're doing. All of them want to say something about what's going on. And all of them want to do or say something. And it is so energizing. And I thank the teachers for what they do here. They have an awesome job because I don't know how they do it. I'm trying to remember when I was that age. It's very difficult, but as I oftentimes say, they need to roll back the sugar a little bit, you know. But they are so full of energy, and it is such a joy to be around them, and I sure am glad they go home to you. All right? And anyone that's raised children know that, right? And as you get older, as I have grandchildren now, it is such a joy to interact with them and spoil them and fill them full of sugary drinks and send them home, all right? So it is such a blessing, and thank you for coming this morning and letting us share with you and also your children with us. And for sake of time here this morning, most sermons have a beginning, a middle, and an end. I'm going to try to go to the end. How many of you believe that? No, really, I'm going to try. But I was mindful of these children this morning that it is such, at their age right now, it is so easy to tell them about God. Amen? It's so easy. And again, the staff here does such a great job. I watch some of the children, and they're smiling and marching. I have decided to follow Jesus. And it reminds me of what the proverb writer says, that we should train up a child when they're young in the way that they should go, and when they're old, they will not depart. What we do know is the older you get, before you say yes to Jesus, the numbers go down, which makes sense. That young children, young people are ready to say yes to Jesus, but as we get old, sometimes we get a little cynical. Sometimes we get a little hard. Sometimes life just caves in on us. And as we get older, it's harder to move away from what my eyes see and what I experience to begin to believe in an invisible God, which is kind of where we're at with Elijah this morning. I am going to trust you to read 1 Kings 19. How many of you will do that? Well, at least you're honest, okay? Because I won't go into that story other than Elijah was a great prophet of God. He just had a big showdown with all these false prophets and this stuff. And God literally had answered fire from heaven, and Elijah was excited. Jezebel, of course, was the queen. Ahab was the king. And, of course, they killed, as we read this morning, the false prophets who said God wasn't God, Baal is God. And that kind of made Jezebel mad. And so Jezebel sent word to Elijah that, like you killed the false prophets, actually he didn't, the people did, but he told them to do it, that I'm going to kill you tomorrow, so you're a dead man. So suddenly Elijah got afraid, and the rest of the story is he ran for his life. And it's through this we began to see, perhaps ourselves, that when Elijah prayed, he was in desperation. He was beat. He was scared. And the reason I use that as an illustration this morning is that how many of us have been at a time or many times, maybe you are right now in your life, when you are afraid of whatever's going on in your life, or you have went through an enormous amount of trial and temptation and you wonder where God is. You wonder, did God or does God pay attention to me? That in all of my sufferings and all of my this and all of my that, that what we recognize in the scriptures, the two that I chose this morning, is that it's obvious when we pray. Jesus made this a central part of the Sermon on the Mount and his ministry, prayer. as Susan led us in prayer this morning, we want to be a church known for prayer. Amen?
Amen.
Prayer changes things. And I know sometimes we'd like to speed prayer up, but prayer is more than a wish list or a want list. It is our communion with God. It is the time that we have, hopefully several times, Paul reminds us to pray without ceasing. I would not advise you to drive down the road and close your eyes and pray. But I would say you can pray all the time in your heart. You can pray all the time, literally almost, in everything you do, because as we see in the book of Romans, that God is making intercession for us in groanings and utterings, that life is not static. There's more going on with God than we can really understand, but I'll come back to that in just a minute. So we oftentimes pray in weakness, but Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount that when you pray, so it's not if you pray, it's just when you pray. And then on top of that, we see the disciples came to Jesus twice with requests in this respect. They said, Lord, teach us to pray. Now that seems kind of ludicrous because they would have known how to pray. But what they evidently saw is Jesus prayed differently. There was something different about the way Jesus prayed. So they wanted to pray, as Jesus reminds us, that we should not use vain repetitions. Make our prayer meaningful. As you go to the book of James chapter 5, and you'll read that he mentions Elijah in this passage, that he was just like us. We have to sometimes take the great people of God like David and Elijah and Moses and Abraham and all of them and bring them down to where we live to recognize they had nothing more special than us. That they stumbled through life, sometimes blindly just like the rest, but they had a relationship with God and God met them and they met God and they made it through. And God has used them as an example. So James says Elijah was just like us, a man who has the same passions, the same dreams, the same fears, the same everything. So he's just reminding us that Elijah is just like us. He's a regular, ordinary guy. So when we look at him, we don't need to look at him as some supernatural being that's outside of my realm, but a man that was filled with passion, that one day he was on a mountaintop with God and the next day he's running for his life, scared to death. Anybody ever experienced that, or am I the only one? So we see that here. And so they asked Jesus, Lord, teach us to pray. And that's kind of where another example of the Lord's Prayer comes into. Pray this way. Then they came to Jesus another time and said, Lord, increase our faith. And then he taught them again. He turned right to prayer. And this time he said, if you have faith of a grain of a mustard seed. And most of us have been told that's this real tiny itty-bitty little seed that if you put it in the ground, it grows into this great big tree. And it's a wonderful illustration that Jesus uses. That if we have just that faith of a grain of mustard seed, we can say to that mountain, you go from here to there, or you can say to the mulberry tree, pluck yourself up and go over here to the sea and stay right there and grow. And he said, and nothing will be impossible for you. I don't know about you, but I read those two scriptures and go, man, that's hyperbole. That moving mountains and moving trees, it's almost ludicrous in that how do you move a mountain and how do you move a tree? And that's his point. He's not using hyperbole. He's actually using a very well-known illustration in his day that all of us here in living, we are perplexed from time to time. Things come in our life that are beyond our control. Amen?
Amen.
It can be relationship in that it's a spouse. It can be your children. You know, nothing will make your hair turn gray faster than children. I had three. Actually, my wife had three. I helped. But nothing will drive parents to despair more than children. Is that true? And spouses, of course, too. I'm not trying to. But children, just because they get to that place in life and you can't talk to them, because they already know everything, right? And so I'm not trying to be too funny here, but most of us have raised children in the modern time, and it's a real challenge. So we are faced with perplexities and other things, sicknesses and illnesses. That's another example of something that happens that drives us to our knees. It perplexes us. It perplexes doctors as well. So we look to God and we pray to God. We pray to God for healing. We pray to God for our children. We pray to God for our spouses. We pray just like Jesus said, move the mountain and move the tree. And we wonder, what's happening, God? I don't see my prayer answered. Well, if you go now to Romans chapter 8, we'll get to the end of the message. Somebody say, thank you, Jesus, for that. Thank you for being honest. All right? Paul reminds the Romans. First, in Romans chapter 8, 11, we that have said yes to Jesus, have the same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. That's some awesome power, isn't it? That's where we start. We have the spirit of Christ in us. Then Paul goes on to tell us we don't know what to pray for. Now, I know if I'm sick, I'm going to pray. I know if my children are in need, I'm going to pray. I know if my spouse is in need and this and that, I'm going to pray. I know that. But I don't know the big picture. You have been told before and seen the pictures of the iceberg. How many of you have seen an iceberg? And how many of you know the Titanic? They didn't see the iceberg. But we know that just a little piece is at the top, and you got this huge mass right under the surface. And I think that's what God is trying to tell us, that in our affliction, when you read Paul's affliction in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, we have an example that Paul had a reoccurring ailment. He calls it a thorn in the flesh, not a splinter, something that is reoccurring. Just for the sake of this, I'm going to say it could be diabetes. It could be some heart issues. It could be something that is always there pressing. You feel it. You can't get away from it. And the way Paul phrases it, it's so reoccurring, it can get his mind off of God. It can get his mind from serving God and onto himself and his problems. That's what he's saying here. So he says, God, I prayed to you three times for you to remove this problem. So we see now that Paul's a man of faith and a man who believes in healing. Because we see in the scripture where God used him to heal people. But now it's his turn. And the answer Paul gets is, my grace is sufficient for you. In other words, Romans chapter 8 is in play here. We don't know what to pray for, but the Spirit, through groanings and other things, is making intercession for us and God, because all things work together. You hear that? All things work together for good. And I don't know about you, but what that starts to tell me is I've got to be patient. I don't know about you. Sometimes I don't have any patience. And if you want to see proof of that, follow me to a restaurant where there's a long line. Oh, you too, huh? You go in a restaurant like today. I'm watching the clock. I'm almost done. Like today, you go to a restaurant, and they got some people sitting there, and the first thing you ask is, what's the wait time, right? What's the wait time? Anybody ever leave after you're told the wait time? Anybody ever go, I'm not waiting 45 minutes in this place. They don't have good enough food for me to wait 45 minutes. So all things work together for good, for you. That's what I wanted you to take home today with you. That when you pray, you need to ask God, whatever it is, to heal, to touch your children, and do whatever it is, But be mindful as God, He's working it out for a final solution. That when it's done, it's done. As Paul says, my grace is sufficient for you, for in weakness I grow strong. Meaning in my weakness, God grows strong. It gets us focused on God and off of ourselves. That it's the iceberg. God's working below the surface. That God knows exactly where you are. God knows exactly what's going on. And that's why Jesus is here. Amen? Jesus is here to help us because He made us a promise. I will be with you through all of your trials, all your tribulations, all of your persecutions. So that's why I love the children when they said that, quoting Ephesians, and there's other places you can quote as well, to give thanks to who? God. Give thanks to God for all things. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for our children, because truly they are an inspiration to us and for us. That you have reminded us that we should become as children. And Lord, it behooves us to watch how they think and how they live, and how you have said that is the simple way of faith. That Lord, help us to see that and help us to live as that child in faith. That whatever we do ask, it will be done, but it may not be done the way I think it is. It may not be done exactly the way I think it should be. But you have heard it. It's written down. The answer's on the way. Help us, Lord, just to give you thanks for that answer. And Lord, I pray for all the parents and grandparents here today that are raising these young children. People have always had a challenge to raise children in the right way. But we know today there's so much pressure to do the wrong thing. It is, seems to me so much easier to do the wrong thing than the right thing. So help the parents, grandparents to teach the children the right way, and also the children to hear that. And you get it in their heart that when evil comes, they can say no. That when temptation comes, they can say no. When you come into their heart, they say yes. Give them all a blessing today. In Christ's name, I ask it and pray. Amen.